Sydney Airport's much, much more than just a place where people come to get on and off aeroplanes. We're very much an entire industry, a miniature city within a city, if you will. The aircraft taxiing out is one of the older 737s. I do say older, but I must remind you that the Virgin Blue fleet is currently the youngest commercial fleet in the world at the moment because of their a lot of brand new aeroplanes. And this one out here to our left, which will come onto the bay after the other one departs, is one of their newest aircraft. This one out here in front of us is a 737-400. It carries about 145 passengers. Another 737 out there. 737. Allow them more gates for a start. Six permanent gates and the options of taking up to six more gates. They only have a maximum of five parking bays here, so that'll be a huge improvement for passenger embarkation and disembarkation. Of course, you might have seen the huge queue as you came past, people waiting to check in. Much bigger and more luxurious areas over at the Ansett terminal. Ground Marshal just marshalling the aircraft onto the bay there. You can see him in front of the aircraft, getting him to stop by crossing the paddles over above his head. That was almost what he was supposed to be doing. It did the right thing. Got the aircraft stopped in the right spot. Aircraft over at the bigger terminals, of course, no longer require ground marshals. The most of the larger and more modern terminals are far more advanced than that. Laser beams are used to guide the aircraft onto the bay. Aero bridges and a number of other smaller bays for regional aircraft. It now has four, and once Virgin Blue move in, five tenants will all be using this facility, including a lot of ex-regional partners of Ansett, like Aero Pelican. You can see their little aircraft, the Twin Otter, coming right to left in front of the bus. With only 18 passenger seats on board, this is one of the smallest aircraft regularly in and out of Sydney Airport. It forces to become an independent regional carrier now known as Rex, your Regional Express. You can see their little Saab 340 aircraft down there to the right-hand side. Qantaslink are also using this terminal, as are Horizon. And Virgin Blue will make five tenants to this terminal. The sort of impact that the collapse of Ansett last year had was quite profound. I'm not sure everybody is fully aware that at Sydney Airport on the 13th of September we had 900 air traffic movements. Overnight Ansett collapsed, and on the 14th of September Sydney Airport had 600 air traffic movements. One third of all air traffic for Sydney Airport was coming out of this one terminal building here on the right hand side. Sydney Airport's authority purchased the building for around $200 million from the administrators. It's a bit of a bargain basement price, that, of course. $200 million was the amount of money spent on the extensions to this terminal before the Olympics. But good to see the terminal back up and running again after being our biggest ghost town for almost a year. The regional aircraft, like the Dash 8s from Qantaslink, operate. Qantaslink is the umbrella name that covers all of the Qantas regional partners, including Eastern Australia, who own the Dash 8, Sunstate Airlines from Queensland, and of course Impulse, flying the Boeing 717s. You can see that over here at the Aero Bridge on the right hand side. Not a lot of buildings exist from the very early days of Sydney Airport. One or two of them do. This one over here on the right under the Qantas sign is in fact the oldest building still standing here at Sydney Airport, built back in 1941 as our very first ever outside of the United States. Last year, Sydney Airport was ranked as about the 42nd busiest airport in the world. To give you an idea of where we stand on a world scale, our 26 million passengers last year compares to Atlanta Airport last year, who had 81 million passengers through their door as the world's busiest airport for passengers. That's one of the new 737-800s you can see here on the right-hand side. They're allowed to be built larger, primarily because of the extra lift created by the new wing design. The winglets extend 2.2 metres above the top of the wingtip, giving the aircraft wing a considerable amount of extra lift and allowing the aircraft to fly further using less fuel, but then also to be built slightly larger as well. It can be used for international flights. There's a Polynesian aircraft from Samoa out there in front of us, another 737-800. It's not often you get to see a jumbo at the domestic terminal, but of recent times, especially for very popular holiday flights to places like Cairns in North Queensland, they've been required to upgrade the size of their aircraft right up to the 747-300. This is one of the most photographed aircraft in the world, of course, known as Nalanji Dreaming. The 747-300 is also considered the most heavily painted jumbo in the world, and the paint alone on the outside of this aircraft weighs around 2.2 tonnes. That's a pretty heavy paint job. Qantas have more than 120 jet aircraft on their fleet. and that makes them far and away the biggest airline in Australia, and also the oldest international airline in Australia as well. At 82 years old, only KLM is a few months older than Qantas. And of course, testament to their indeed showing a drop. 48 man hours, or one full working day for six people to wash a jumbo. That's one of the classics, one of the 747-200s. The much shorter upper deck, you can see some of these aircraft are approaching. some of these
will get out of the way pretty quickly, don't you? There you go.
McDonnell Douglas MD-11. Operated by Federal Express. Now, FedEx carry not one passenger, of course, but they do carry or own, or fly, I should say, more aircraft than any other major airline in the world. So even though they don't carry any passengers, they do have the largest fleet of jet aircraft in the world, and that's one of them. You see there on the right-hand side. Slightly larger than the old DC-10s, but called the MD-11. Now a design owned by the Boeing company. And out of production. Can not only fly non-stop Sydney to San Francisco, it can fly non-stop San Francisco to Sydney against the wind with a full passenger load, something that they've never been able to do before. This aircraft carries extra fuel. This is the heaviest jet to leave, heaviest passenger aircraft to leave Sydney Airport in history when it takes off this afternoon. Maximum takeoff weight of 412 tonnes on takeoff. It'll carry 250,000 litres of fuel with it. By the time it touches down on the other side of the Pacific, it will only weigh 250 tonnes. It will burn 160 tonnes of fuel on the flight. Passengers will eat their way through 5.5 tonnes of food on the same flight as well. So there's a fair catering bill involved. At 412 tonnes, it's a fairly hefty thing to get off the ground, of course. You need some pretty powerful engines. Each of the four engines on this aircraft can generate more than 27 tonnes of thrust per engine on takeoff. It's around 55,000 horsepower per engine. On its flight, of course, the flight can conceivably take anywhere up to 14 and a half hours in either direction in the worst possible weather conditions. And being on that aircraft for that amount of time, you'd want a little bit of extra entertainment, a few other things to do, even on economy class seats on this aircraft. Everybody gets their own television screen. Keeps the kids quiet, they can play their Nintendo games or whatever else they want. Good fun. So there you go, the world's biggest passenger jet and the heaviest aircraft. Statistics-wise, or size-wise, it's exactly the same as the 747-400 in length, 70 metres long, 60 metres wide, around about 6 stories tall at the tail. Boeing, of course, are building a series of low-cost international long-haul wide-bodied aircraft as well, like this one here, the Boeing 777. Have a look at the size of the engines on this aircraft, and they're considerably larger than the ones you see on a jumbo. Each of these engines is capable of producing around 40 tonnes of thrust per engine on takeoff. That's around 78,000 horsepower per engine. These engines will suck more air into their intake in 1 minute than you'll suck into your lungs in your lifetime. And they will be able to suck you into the intake if you're standing in front of one at takeoff velocity from about 35 metres away. So pretty powerful stuff. Boeing's major competitor, of course, is a company from Europe called Airbus Industries, and this is one of their aircraft here, the A330. It's in the process of being refuelled at the moment. You can see the blue and white truck underneath the wing there. A network of fuel pipelines underneath all of the domestic and international aprons is feeding these trucks. The trucks then transfer the fuel from the pipelines through the truck, through the hoses and up into the underwing of the aircraft at rates of up to 3,500 litres a minute. Now that'll refuel your car in 3/4 of a second, or refuel that jumbo back over there in 3/4 of an hour. As the fuel pipe... You might be pleased to know that even though we don't build a lot of aeroplanes, we are often in the aviation industry in a big way. The tug vehicle you can see out there to the left-hand side is built by the Bliss Fox company. In fact, in Australia we design, build and export 70% of the world's tug vehicles. So we don't build an awful lot of aeroplanes, but gee, we supply the airports with tugs to a massive degree. Tugs, of course, are required to push all jet aircraft off the base. Aircraft are capable of moving along the ground under their own power, should that ever be necessary. Backwards, in fact. But they're not allowed permitted to do so away from terminal buildings. These engines are incredibly powerful, and if you were to start these engines and use the aircraft's own engine power to push itself away from terminals, in some circumstances, it's more than capable of blowing windows out of the terminal buildings. In fact, the Argentine Airbus around the corner here, Aerolíneas Argentinas, A340 Airbus, is being pushed away from the terminal by the tug vehicle. Another British Airways aircraft off to the right hand side, this time with the Scottish tail. The repainting of all of the tails on the British Airways aircraft into the